Welcome back, dear students. Welcome to our lecture 6 of marine refrigeration. In this lecture, I would be discussing about Carnot refrigerator on a TS plot of a real refrigerant R134A. The discussion is important in the way that it is the first thermodynamic cycle that we are going to study for as a refrigeration cycle. We will develop some understanding and intuition of functioning of refrigerators from this discussion and learning, and that we will consider the cases of say why a Carnot refrigerator is the best possible refrigerator between two given temperatures, and also we will discuss the issues of practicality of a cycle, and then we will finally develop our first practicable refrigeration cycle, that is a vapor compression cycle. So let us start our discussion. First, I would like you to get a grasp of the plot that is in front of you. It is a property diagram, temperature and specific entropy, that is temperature along y-axis and specific entropy along x-axis. The scale of temperature is here marked degree centigrade for easier grasp, but for the calculations always remember that you should use only thermodynamic scale of temperatures only. So we have studied property diagrams in the first semester when we were discussing properties of pure substances. This is a two-phase diagram for R134A, meaning there are two phases in this plot. If I mark any point on this plot, it will tell me a state. Okay. So let us see, watch very carefully at the bottom left of the active window. I will bring a crosshair, then you can find the properties here. You see, the moment I am bringing this crosshair and moving across this plot, each point is describing all properties. So each point is a state point. You can see here. Right, so each point is a state point. We can precisely get all other readings by a simple dot on this plot. To enhance our understanding, there are certain lines which are plotted usually. These lines are something like, say, a guidance for a person reading the plot. Okay, we will study why they are very important. So first let us start with a point on this plot, which I will call it critical point. This point on the plot is a critical point. Okay, so you can see it about 101.31 degrees centigrade. R134 is critical temperature. So I would draw a line here and I would explain to you various things that we have already studied. Just for a quick recap, it is beneficial to study once again. So let us draw the first line on the diagram, that is something like this. It's a straight line. Okay, this is the temperature T critical temperature line, which is the line. It extends. You can extend it like this also. That is the line of critical temperature for R134A. So region that is bounded by this dark line of the plot, this dark line that is there, black colored line, I am traversing on it. This line is known as saturated liquid line. Saturated liquid line. And R134a exists as liquid in this region to the left of this saturated liquid line. It is also referred to as subcooled region, subcooled liquid region. We will study subsequently. Okay, the entire region bounded by this saturated liquid line and temperature critical, this region is all liquid. So if I mark any point here, R134a is existing there in that state as liquid. And if I mark several points on the plot and join by this thick dark black line, that is called saturated line. What are all these dots? These dots are saturated liquid points. Okay, so if I join by a smooth curve, I will get saturated liquid line. And after the critical point, if I mark all the saturated vapor points, and if I join by a smooth curve, I will get saturated vapor line. Saturated vapor line. Now R134a exists as a vapor. This is called superheated region, superheated vapor. And beyond the critical temperature, we usually refer to as gas. Okay. Under the dome, R134a exists as liquid vapor mixture. That means at any one point, if I mark it, okay, I take any random sample of mass m, and I put a point here to obtain its state, then it conveys a meaning that some part of the mass that I have chosen is as vapor and the other part is as a liquid. So what is indicated, or what is the indicating parameter here, is the faint gray lines which are running from the critical point. If you notice, these lines are called lines of constant dryness fraction. That means if I choose any point on this line, here or here or here or here or here, anywhere, the dryness fraction is 0.2, and if I choose here, it is 0.4. in between, you can linearly interpret between these two lines. Okay, the meaning there, these are the lines of constant dryness fraction. I have marked the points here where x equals to 0.2, right? So what is dryness fraction? It is mass of vapor by total mass of the system. That is, if I take 100 grams of say R134a, and if it is in this state point, okay, that is dryness fraction 2. That means my mass of vapor is 0.2 multiplied by 100 grams is equals to mg, and the mass of liquid would be, so how much is this coming down to, 20 gram. and the rest of the mass is as liquid. That is the meaning on this line. So similarly we can have 0.4 and so on. So you can find, you can even plot many lines for a closer examination. So there are certain charts made available by various publishers where you can carefully read all the data. So the one line that you have now noticed is a dry line of constant dryness fraction. Okay. Similarly, there is a dotted line which is which are running here, something like this. Okay, these dotted lines are lines of constant specific volume. So specific volume is constant. Okay, if you choose any point on this line, that means the specific volume of R134A will be 0.27. that is the meaning on this line. I can choose anywhere the specific volume would be 0.27. And similarly there is a thin dark lines which are running, which are marked on this plot. Those are the lines of constant pressure, meaning if I put any point on the line, okay, any point, the pressure of R12, vapor pressure of R134A would be, this is 300 kPa, so it will correspond to 300 kPa. Clear? And the lines can be extended into the liquid region also. Okay? The lines can be extended into the liquid region, something like this. We will see a much more detailed graph subsequently. So we have seen most of the lines that are marked here. So they present some guidance which tells something like this. This is a region bounded by saturated liquid line and saturated vapor line. Underneath, R134A will exist as liquid plus vapor mixture. Plus vapor mixture, saturated region. Clear? And any point we can read, or once we know the state, we can find any property of the component, that is R134A. So that is a quick recap of the plot. Now one may notice that the lines of constant pressure are horizontal. Okay, and in the dome, under the dome region, meaning that the liquid is changing its phase. Here it is just liquid, and the what is the meaning of saturated liquid here? It means that if you add any amount of small thermal energy at this point, okay, any small amount of energy, the R134A is ready to change its phase at constant temperature and constant pressure. So if you maintain the vapor pressure, the temperature is fixed. If you fix the temperature, the vapor pressure is fixed. That is the interdependency of temperature and pressure in this region while undergoing phase change. Okay, the moment the a given mass is totally converted to vapor, where dryness fraction just becomes 1, it is called saturated vapor. And saturated vapor is discussed in the other way around, that if you remove any small energy from that particular vapor, it is ready to change its phase under constant temperature or pressure. So you fix temperature constant, the vapor pressure is constant, and vice versa. So it is ready to change its phase. So a liquid ready to change its phase, you can call, is called saturated at that point. So you are joining all that regions to get saturated liquid line, and you are joining all the saturated vapor lines, state points, to get this saturated vapor line. Okay, that is the interpretation of this plot. So we will erase it quickly, and let us try to impose a Carnot refrigerator on this plot. Okay, this is where the it becomes interesting. So we have earlier seen what is a Carnot cycle, a Carnot refrigerator. Without going into the nitty-gritties, we have said we have discussed the thermodynamic cycle, and we called it as vapor, that is Carnot cycle. Here today we will see, we will read more into it. So a Carnot cycle on TS diagram would look like a rectangle or a square, something like this, right? So I will position it in a way that it is in the two phase region. I may position it slightly outer or slightly to the left, okay, but as long as two phases are there, I can always call it a vapor Carnot cycle. So we have started off with the say marking of state points for each process. There are four processes, okay. This is one state point, this is state point two, we can mark it state point three, state point four, and thermodynamic cycle is being executed in this direction. Okay, this is the TL and this is the TH, right? This is the notation that we have used earlier. So to be very precise, let us consider a case which is very particular, that we will fix parameters, such as say we will take our, we will take the crosshair help to see. We have placed it roughly on 40 degrees, okay, TH, and TL is minus 20 degrees centigrade. This is what I wanted, in fact, to set it up. That is, I have chosen carefully my TH to be 40 degrees centigrade. So 40 degrees centigrade okay, this is 40 degrees centigrade, and I have taken TL as minus 20 degrees centigrade, okay. I'm marking that to continuously remind you that not to wrongly use the units for calculations, okay. So by defining what is that we have taken, say consider a normal summer day where outside ambience is about 40 degrees centigrade, and we are required to store certain food items frozen at minus 20 degrees centigrade. That is our requirement. And we are first trying to see the first refrigeration cycle that we are considering is a Carnot cycle. Okay, so our case is set. We will form our discussions using this understanding, this case. So what we should understand first are two important things. we don't have control on TH or TL. They are fixed. That is a requirement. In fact, TL is dictated by atmospheric conditions, ambient conditions or surroundings. So I would call ambient or surrounding conditions. It is fixed by nature. In case of a ship, it is the seawater temperature. Okay, if it is a land based, say a split air conditioner or something like that, the ambient air would be the air temperature, outside air temperature. And TL is specified as a requirement, our requirement, or it is a requirement. So we don't have actually a control on these parameters, they are fixed. Okay, and for such a case we have said that COP, coefficient of performance for a refrigeration cycle, is specified by what is desired. What is desired is Q dot L is a refrigeration load, and what is a net work in you have to provide to the refrigerator, network. Okay, so before getting into this, let us see all the individual processes. Now the refrigerated space is here, so this is where the thermal energy is added to the refrigerant. This line, horizontal line 4 to 1 is evaporator coil. Okay, let us say after that Q dot L is transferred to the refrigerant, R134A is at state 1. From state 1 to state 2, you see it's a isentropic compression. We are calling this one as isentropic compression. It is a compressor, so we have to input some work. It is called isentropic compression. Okay, why did we call compression? Is because if you look at the lines of constant specific volume here, if you look at, say the line may pass something like this between say 0.27 and 0.1, exactly midway. Whereas if you look at it, is close to say, or the midway between 0.015 and 0.039, specific volume is reduced from 1 to 2. And we have a quick parameter, that is density is given by 1 by specific volume. Density is increasing, you are compressing basically. That is the reason why this isentropic process from 1 to 2 is called isentropic compression, and we have to put a compressor here so as to compress from 1 to 2. Now this Q dot L, the thermal energy transfer from the refrigerated space, this is a refrigerated space, it is happening. Okay, if you look at very carefully, it is happening isothermally. Okay, this is a refrigerated space. And the property of R134A are such that we could achieve a thermal energy addition at constant temperature, that is isothermal. So isothermal heat addition we have achieved. Why? Because that R134A is undergoing a phase change. So if you fix the vapor pressure, the temperature is maintained constant. So isothermal, say heat addition. heat addition to what? Heat addition to refrigerant. Okay, that you should carefully interpret or read, because we are referring to system now as the refrigerant which is circulating. So the behavior of R134a is such that we could achieve isothermal heat addition as it was undergoing a phase change. Okay, and at phase state 2 we have considered it is just dry saturated vapor at the end of compression process. Now here it has to reject the thermal energy to the surroundings, ambient. By convention we have marked it as Q dot H. It is also happening at isothermal condition. Why? Because the dry saturated vapor is giving up its energy, and so it is changing its phase, and we have chosen state 3 as saturated liquid, that is all the vapor, dry vapor is completely condensed. Okay, so this is by notation Q dot H, and this is we have achieved isothermal heat rejection. Now 3, it is saturated liquid. We have to isentropically bring it to 4, state 4, and we are calling it as expansion process, right? You may realize certain work output at this point by imagining that I will put some, say, hypothetical isentropic turbine there, and I would develop certain work from it. So my net work now will become what is that I have supplied to the refrigerator minus what is that I have realized in expansion. So that is the net work I have to supply to the refrigerator. Clear? Now we are calling it as expansion, isentropic expansion. Isentropic expansion, because you can make it out similarly by following the lines that specific volume is increasing. So we are calling it as an expansion process. So that completes our Carnot cycle for the purpose to achieve a refrigeration at an ambient temperature of 40 degrees, where the requirement is to maintain minus 20 degrees in the refrigerator space. And we have successfully described a Carnot cycle which is working for the time being. Believe that equipment are there which makes this possible. Later on we will come and see the practicality in real life situation, whether such components can really exist or not. For the time being, it is understood that such a cycle is workable. We are going on that hypothesis. Okay, so COPR is given by this ratio. What is desired cooling load and what is required, how much power you have to supply to the functioning of the refrigerator. And we have also seen earlier that Carnot cycle, since it is comprising of four different processes which are completely reversible, we say that this functioning of cycle will not increase entropy of the universe. That is Q dot H will be Q dot H by TH will be equals to Q dot L by TL. If you recapture from our earlier video lectures, we have said that the second, from the second law diagram, we have drawn something like this. Okay, we have seen that this kind of possibility exists, where this is TH, this is QH, this is work net, this is Q dot L, this is TL. We have said that such a functioning of a refrigerator is only possible for a condition which is imposed by second law, which is something like this. If QH by TH is greater than or equals to Q dot L by TL. Only then such a thermodynamic cycle is possible, right? Because the law of entropy says for any say functioning, you can either generate entropy of the universe, or at most that hypothetically by all reversible process you can leave it unchanged, something like this, all reversible internally and as externally. And what are the real refrigerators doing? The real refrigerators, this is Carnot refrigerator, all other real refrigerators, they increase entropy of the universe in their functioning, right? From these two conditions you can clearly interpret that if I fix my TH and TL by the prevalent ambient condition and the required refrigeration temperature, you can define COP for R for Carnot as 1 upon TH by TL minus 1. This is only for Carnot refrigerator, okay, this relation. Whereas the other relation, this works for all real as well as Carnot refrigerator. Further, you may write this expression as Q dot L by Q dot H minus Q dot L. Following law of conservation of energy, we can write work net as difference between these two energies, that is this plus this is equals to this. Q dot L plus W dot net in is Q dot H. Okay, now if you use this interpretation, that is real refrigerator, real refrigerator, if you put this expression, you will clearly note that only Carnot refrigerator will demand the least work net in. A real refrigerator would definitely demand more work than a Carnot refrigerator for its functioning in the same set of conditions. You put this relation into this relation, you will find it instantly. That is the reason why we said between two temperature limitations, Carnot refrigerator is the best possible refrigerator. No other refrigerator can have a higher COP than a Carnot refrigerator working between two temperatures. That is the conclusion for today. This is also the generalization. So for all thermodynamic cycles, I will generalize it now, that for all thermodynamic cycles, when they are operating between two sets of temperature, the least work input is demanded by a Carnot refrigerator. Any real refrigerator will demand more work than a Carnot refrigerator. Okay, that is the generalization. And second thing, which may look very tricky, but we should get to that point also. By stating that COPR is 1 by TH by TL minus 1, it appears that when the temperature zone comes towards each other, that is when TH and TL are almost in the close proximity, TH and TL, it becomes approaching to 1, and 1 approaching 1 means 1 point something 000 something, then the Carnot refrigerator COP is very high. Okay, so it may give a kind of hope that if I reduce this say by, or if I execute the same refrigeration by considering very small, minutely operating carnet refrigerators in the close, and each one will be exchanging energy and I may produce COPR. But what happens is you are adding work at each point, and finally you would land up with the same conclusion, COPR. Later on we will see that cycle, that this kind of concept is called cascading, and we will study at a later stage, but it is too early to state that refrigeration cycle. But what you should understand is between two given temperatures, because they are fixed, you don't have a control on it. Carnot refrigerator is the best possible refrigerator. So I would leave this task of proving that on to the students by asking them to put this relation here. If you put, you will immediately realize. Okay, this inequality. So by inequality you can prove that Carnot refrigerator is the best refrigerator. Okay, now I'll wipe off this screen, it has become cluttered. Okay, and now we will discuss practicality of the cycle. So let us draw our Carnot cycle again. Okay, between somewhere around 40 degrees to minus 20. The same cycle I am trying to draw a little bit here and there is fine, approximate. So let us mark our state points again. 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. So we have understood the processes and the behavior of the refrigerant has made isothermal process by default. Okay, and we are considering a hypothetical isentropic compressor to take it from state 1 to state 2. Okay, now if you carefully watch, what is the state of R134a here? What is the state of R134a at this point? If I call, it is as saturated liquid plus vapor. It is as saturated liquid plus vapor. Now most of the compressors that we employ usually are reciprocating in nature. Okay, reciprocating in nature, because they are the, say you can say positive displacement equipment, reciprocating nature. Okay, they are positive displacement, so the characteristic benefit, they are functioning between a very large differential pressure for one reason. Secondly, these positive displacement equipment are best suited for handling low volumetric flows of fluids. But the rotodynamic, the other option, rotodynamic compressors also you may have, but they are ideally better in handling large volumetric flows. Okay, so keep that in mind. So most of the compressors that we encounter on ships are reciprocating in nature. Now a reciprocating compressor cannot handle liquid, because liquid is not compressible. So when the piston moves inside the cylinder, if a liquid fills in that volume, the piston is having mechanical linkages, right? It is functioning by working in a cylinder. If I fill this volume with say liquid, then what will happen? It is not compressible, the piston can't lift up. but you are driving with, say, an electrical motor, then it is likely that the mechanical components will break. Okay, so liquid should be avoided in the suction of compressor. That is the first practicality we are finding. Now we are coming to practical issues. So when we are using these reciprocating compressors, first thing is you cannot have liquid in the suction. So this point is ruled out now. We cannot have this point. Okay. So I will draw it with a line. I will draw it with a thick line so that you will understand. We said that at minus 20, this is the point. Okay, it at most it can be on the saturated vapor line, okay, on the saturated vapor line, or it can be in the vapor region, because all vapor is okay and just vapor is also okay for compression, because our reciprocating compressor cannot work with liquids. So we have to slightly modify our cycle. So what is that we are doing? We are considering the practicalities, practical issues. We are modifying our cycle so that we can employ it in day-to-day life. So we said at most it should be dry vapor, or into the vapor region is okay, permissible. So the designers would always tend to keep it into the vapor region with some margin, so that even in a small, say the implementation, the manufacture, and even the functioning, any conditions, fluctuations that may arise in the functioning may not bring the vapor to liquid in the usual functioning conditions into the compressor. So it is quite common that manufacturers may use slight the suction of compressor into the vapor region. So we have, for our case, what we will do is we'll fix it on dry saturated vapor, because that is the that is also possible. So let us erase this point and let us modify our process. So we are coming from 40 degrees from 3 here, about roughly here. So we were coming to 4, so now we have modified it into the region, or at most on the dry saturated vapor line. So from here we said we will be executing our isentropic compression. So isentropic compression means we have to follow exactly vertical, right? We have to move exactly vertical. This is isentropic. So once we move, where to move now? Where to move is dictated by the vapor pressure corresponding to saturation pressure at 40 degrees. So this is a 40 degrees line, right? This is a 40 degrees. So the saturation pressure at 40 degrees is 1000 kilopascal, and the line will extend into the vapor region this way. So we have to compress it to that particular pressure. What is that pressure? It is corresponding to the saturation pressure corresponding to our TH. To that point we will compress. And if for the design of our refrigerator, if these limitations are considered, then the designers would always choose a compressor based on such differential pressures. So the suction pressure is dictated by the temperature to be maintained in the refrigerated space after finalizing a refrigerant. Because if you change this refrigerant, the conditions would change, the behavior would change, and it may land up with a different set of properties. So if for a refrigerant, if for a temperature is fixed, then the suction and delivery pressures are fixed and you can identify a compressor. Okay, so we have landed at 2 by isentropic compression. We are approximating basically the compression as isentropic. There could be some irreversibilities. If irreversibilities are there, it would deviate slightly like this towards increasing entropy, and still we would compress it onto the same, say, vapor pressure. Okay, now here we have to affect cooling, because cooling of refrigerant, because it has to exchange the thermal energy to surroundings, and so that it will cool, the refrigerant will start to condense. There is slight problem with this software. Okay, anyway, okay, so the vapor will start to cool, and it will turn to complete liquid at 3. So here we will put condenser, right? Here we have put compressor. For the time being, I don't want to address say certain deviations. I will call that I am still developing an ideal cycle, so I will erase that deviation. That is just for an additional info quite early, but we will study the deviations subsequently. First let us understand an ideal vapor compression cycle. So ideally the vapor is returning back to 3 along this line of constant pressure from 2. At 3 we have said it is isentropic expansion. Here some clarity is required in understanding, because of a condition which we have analyzed here at 1. We said we cannot admit liquid into a reciprocating compressor, so at most you can consider it to be dry saturated or into the superheated region. Here we say that the liquid is at 3 and it is changing its phase to reach state 4 by isentropic expansion process. The difficulty here is the fluid that is flowing through this hypothetical turbine is in two phases. Two phase fluid flow. So accommodating turbines are very difficult to design, are difficult, they are quite complex. Even if you happen to design one, or if you take a good turbine and you say that I would put a high pressure liquid and I would expand it, it cannot be isentropic. Why? Because if a liquid is flowing, okay, and it is changing its phase, it cannot be isentropic anyway, because there would be mechanical impingement onto the blades of the fluid. Just to consider a case, right, these are all irreversibilities which will develop. There could be some, say, high pressure regions, transient conditions which will collapse the vapor bubbles and so on. It cannot be isentropic anyway. So due to the difficulty in designing a two phase turbine, or even if you put saturated liquid into a turbine, it cannot be isentropic. So we are ruling out, so this, due to this difficulty, we are ruling out isentropic expansion, because we cannot find a component which can do exactly like this. So isentropic expansion is ruled out. What is that we are putting here? We are putting one throttling device. Throttling device, we have earlier studied throttling as a thermodynamic process. Okay, this is a throttle valve, if I call it. It's a high pressure side. The fluid is entering a throttling device. It is expanded to a low pressure. We studied it under throttling, and we said here the H1 entering, the fluid entering with enthalpy, say, is remaining constant, and so we call that as more appropriately isenthalpic process. Okay, throttling is an isenthalpic process. You may ask, how is it lowering the temperature then? Okay, it is due to redistribution of this energy. It follows a concept that if you reduce the vapor pressure of a refrigerant, the temperature is also reduced. So there is a relation between vapor pressure and the liquid phase. So if you, for different, say, substances, there would be different temperatures and pressures, but the behavior is observed over all pure substances, that if you reduce vapor pressure, the liquid temperature would come down. And this effect has been utilized earlier on. We discussed in the first presentation a vacuum refrigeration system, which is employing removing the vapor from a refrigerated space containing fresh fruits having a lot of juice and all. Okay, in that we are reducing the vapor pressure. So when you reduce vapor pressure, the temperature of the refrigerant comes down. And also, in an isenthalpic process, enthalpy is maintained constant for two reasons. That once you can consider there is a good insulation there, so there is no thermal interactions of the refrigerant with the surroundings. You can put good insulation around the valve. And also, when a fluid flows, it flows for a small amount of time. So you can consider during that small interval of time, there is no interaction with the surrounding. So in such a condition, you can always say that your U1 plus P1 V1, this is the enthalpy, right? Enthalpy is given by U1 plus P1 V1. Specific enthalpy, I am writing, specific enthalpy, specific internal energy plus pressure plus pressure P1 V1. V1 is a specific volume. This is equal to, we are telling, U2 plus P2 V2. Now when you are at high pressure is very high, the substance specific volume is very low. You can read it out from this graph, this line. Okay, this line, you can read it, interpret. Specific volume is low, whereas here the specific volume is very high and pressure is dropped. Pressure is lesser than at one. So there is a energy is redistributed between internal energy and the flow energy. Okay, and you would always land with a condition where U2 is less than U1, because P2 V2 is more than P1 V1, right? So there is a redistribution of energy from internal energy to flow work, and we landed with this condition. The specific internal energy at step 4 is less than at 3. Okay, so since internal energy is a function of temperature, temperature is also coming down. That is one understanding. So this process is throttling. Okay, so we are removing isentropic process now because it is ruled out. So let us rule out this part. Okay, and we will come by throttling process. Now this throttling process is has to be interpreted very carefully. It is a irreversible process. So sometimes it is not acceptable, or even some teachers may not even accept by drawing a solid line there, because it is not a reversible thing. So you sometimes put it by dots and you are landing somewhere around here. That is our state 4 now. Okay, so we are modifying Carnot cycle in such a way that we can find practicable equipment which we can assemble and construct a refrigerator. So we are trying to identify that practicality over Carnot refrigerator cycle, and we are working our way. So we are saying this is not possible, so modify this is not possible, so modify. And finally we have landed up into a shape. But one thing is very certain, we can achieve this isothermal heat addition and isothermal heat rejection during phase change when the vapor pressure is held constant. So this is a practicable process, isothermal. And we are trying to maintain this discussion. We are slightly modifying Carnot cycle wherever it is not practicable, and in essence we are trying to construct a refrigerator that resembles Carnot refrigerator, because we want to expend lesser and lesser amount of work. Okay, but we cannot achieve lesser work than Carnot refrigerator. That is anyway the general conclusion is. But we cannot start consuming too much amount of work which presents a wasteful input to a refrigerator, because you would be harming the environment by a poorly efficient or poorly designed cycle. So finally, if you conclude now, what we have achieved is a practicable ideal refrigeration cycle. Let us draw it very clearly. Okay, we'll draw it very clearly. We'll wipe off this screen. Okay, what is the shape we have finally arrived at? Recapitulate from the previous screen. Okay, I can okay, so this is our shape of the first practicable cycle. So let us identify by the same state points 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 1. This is the shape of the practicable refrigerator. Okay, we arrived after ruling out those processes which are not practicable by engineering design. So this cycle is known as vapor compression cycle. Vapor compression cycle. So first we have considered Carnot cycle. It is a hypothetical cycle for sure, and we have achieved a practicable working cycle which is called vapor compression cycle. This is the basis for our subsequent studies and engineering analysis. visited. I hope the things are clear at this point, but we can always list out the processes again for clarity. 1 to 2 is we are calling isentropic, it is straight line. Okay, it is a straight line, isentropic compression. Now 2 to 3 we cannot call isothermal process now. Why? Because we are at 2, we are not at the saturated vapor point on the pressure line corresponding to this 40 degrees temperature. Okay, so temperature is decreasing from 2 and then we are reaching that 40, because ambient is at 40, we cannot cool below 40. Even achieving 40 is also a difficult proposition. It will be reached only at the end of a ideal condenser, but we can consider that between this region it is isothermal, but between this region it is not an isothermal heat rejection, so we will call it constant pressure, because pressure is constant, so constant pressure heat rejection. Now 3 to 4 is throttling, or you can call it isenthalpic expansion. Right? Isenthalpic expansion, it is a irreversible process, so I am showing it as dotted. 4 to 1 is here it may appear as isothermal, okay, isothermal heat absorption, but if you say, if you design the state 1 to be in a vapor region, okay, this line cannot go straight, it cannot be isothermal. If it extends into the vapor region, the state 1 will be somewhere on the same pressure line, but at a higher temperature, at a higher temperature, because the vapor is slightly superheated in this region. So even 4 to 1 we will avoid using isothermal, because we will design, usually most of the designers or most of the refrigerators that you will find, the state 1 is in the superheated region, so we will refer 4 to 1 also as constant pressure heat absorption or heat addition. Okay, these are the four processes that are constituting our vapor compression cycle. So this I will call it as ideal vapor compression cycle, because I did not consider the real world problems there, other than saying that this is not possible. But even in a real case situation, you might encounter a lot of pressure losses sometimes, for example, say, okay, inside the tubes due to friction, then due to changing in path direction. So on all those real world problems will modify further the vapor compression cycle, and we will study something known as real vapor compression cycle subsequently. But at this point we will take a break. Okay, so we will stop our lecture at this point with small understanding of usage of property diagram for vapor compression cycle. Because so far we have been discussing Carnot cycle on TS diagram, because Carnot cycles are usually best described on TS because of the regularity in shape that you can achieve, a square or rectangular profile. So that is the reason why you have been using TS. But the shape of this vapor compression cycle is pointing out that there are three processes where some property is constant. Here 2 to 3 pressure is constant, 4 to 1 pressure is constant, 3 to 4 enthalpy is constant. So when we hear about pressure constant and enthalpy constant, naturally the choice of selection for the property diagram for a refrigeration circuit will shift to pH diagram. You watch the screen that I will shift this say the property diagram to pH diagram. I have pulled it out. Okay, I will clear the annotation. Okay, so this becomes a natural choice. Why? Because if you want, you can draw our vapor compression cycle on this property diagram. It looks much more cleaner. In a way, we were working somewhere around 40 degrees. So degrees would be somewhere here. So let us say you may be slightly away, but something like this. This is a away. I will bring the crosshair so that we are at correct point rather than marking somewhere else. Okay. Okay, so if you look at the temperature, where is the 40 degrees coming in? 40 degrees is coming somewhere here, right? Somewhere here we are getting 40 degrees in this region. So I will draw something like this, which is 40 degrees temperature line. Okay, constant pressure, it is a constant pressure process. Enthalpy is along x-axis. Now if you see, specific enthalpy is plotted along x-axis, pressure in kPa is plotted in the y-axis. You have constant temperature lines marked in this way. So line corresponding to minus 20 degrees centigrade would be somewhere here. Clear? Okay. So having identified, we will draw our vapor compression cycle now. So this is heat rejection from say extending to superheated region, and this is the isenthalpic process. Now isenthalpic would appear vertically down because specific enthalpy is plotted on the x-axis. So isenthalpic process would now look straight. Okay, then this is the constant pressure heat addition to the refrigerant. If you look at now how the isentropic lines are looking, this is the lines of constant entropy. Dotted lines are showing lines of constant specific entropy. So between this line is provided and second line is provided. If you see, the slope is somewhat changed. So we have to work out an intermediate line along which we have to join. So isentropic line would look something like this. Okay, so we are marking the same state points 1 to 2 3 to 4 and then back to 1. So this becomes our vapor compression cycle that we have discussed on PS diagram. So PH diagram is more popular with the refrigeration branch because of this reason that there are three straight lines to work with. Okay, so this is the best ideal choice. So you will find that most of the refrigeration charts provided by vendors or the thermodynamics books, they will be using pressure specific enthalpy diagrams. I hope this is understood by the students. And this part I would like to examine a little bit more, the process between 3 to 4 that I am calling it as isenthalpic. If you look at the lines of constant entropy, which I am calling isentropic lines. Okay, these dotted lines are isentropic lines. If you look at their slope, the slope is like this. It's inclined, say by an angle, and it is straightening as you move towards left of the diagram. And when you are arriving here, it is having very small slope, okay, with the vertical. And so you will find that there is a hardly any change between an isentropic process and isenthalpic process. Why this discussion is important is you have negated an expensive component, which is say a turbine, two phase turbine, hypothetical two phase turbine. You have ruled out in favor of a throttling device. A throttling device is very simple. It is just a reducing valve. Okay, you have opted for a throttling valve, negating two phase turbine, which is complex because you shouldn't have achieved benefit anyway by employing a turbine, because the work that you may realize is negated by the complexity of the installation. So a throttling valve is more easier to implement, and so you will find always a throttling valve. Even if you do a small calculation, you will realize that you would not achieve much benefit by introducing a carefully designed turbine, because the work realizable in this region is very minimal. Okay, as isentrope is almost looking like isenthalpy. There is no much difference in the enthalpies between 3 and 4. The realizable work would be very less. So now we will put our energy flows again for understanding. Watch carefully. Q dot L is here. This temperature is our TL. This is our low pressure now. Pressure low. We have listed this issue when we were discussing the refrigeration circuit in one of the video presentation, where we said that a refrigeration circuit can be split up into two halves, one half as low pressure side and the other half as high pressure side. So this is the low pressure side, low pressure, and this corresponds to the high pressure. So this is high pressure. This is high pressure. So the cycle is essentially operating between high pressure and low pressure, and so that was the understanding we have achieved much earlier, considering the practical cycle. So we have marked QL here. This is the work input to an isentropic compressor. So work in, this is the energy exchange with the surroundings by a constant pressure heat removal. This is isenthalpic expansion. So if you want to introduce dots, you can even introduce the dots. So you can say that I cannot write something continuous line, so you may include a dotted. Okay, so this is a dotted line. So it is an isenthalpic expansion, so you cannot realize work in this process. There is no work realizable. Okay, now our calculations become much simpler, because work in is the net work in to a refrigerator now. Clear? So our COP, coefficient of performance for that refrigerator, will now be Q dot L by work in, because we have, there is no work output between 3 to 4. So it has become this. This is for a real refrigerator. Okay, now the clarity is achieved in our discussions. Few more things we will study, we can study, but we will continue it in the next video lecture. For now we will call it off. In the next video lecture, I will first introduce you to the pH diagram in detail. I will bring out a much elaborate the property diagram, and we will superimpose our this vapor compression cycle, ideal vapor compression cycle, we will superimpose again, and we will study in depth, just like how we have analyzed the TS property diagram. We will analyze pH diagram very carefully, and that forms our basis for calculation. I hope the things are clear. Let us call it off for now. Thank you.